Uncharted has made something of a name for itself. As one of Sony's first-party flagship series, it has spawned 4 mainline games, a spin-off PS Vita game, a standalone PS4 expansion, a digital collectible card game.
Well, we're doing a lot.
And a major motion picture starring the big Spider-Man himself, that critics have called one of the movies ever made. Few franchises have the opportunity to create something for consumers to enjoy and explore with longevity, and fewer still retain a certain quality to deserve such an extensive time in their world. Makes me wonder about you, Dominic Toretto. Kidding, I can't weigh in here. I stopped watching after 2. This one's for my family. But over the course of a decade of releases, I believe that Uncharted has earned that title. Hi, I'm Topher, and I'm the voice in your head telling you, get rid of the tomato paste in your fridge. Used it once to make bolognese 6 months ago, and now the fridge smells like shit. This remains one of my favorite gaming series of all time. I've 100% completed the first 3 games, revisited the campaign dozens of times, and finished some of the most bullshitty trophies that come with them. But we will get to that! The amount of time I have dedicated to these games should have me labeled as a madman. I can't tell you when my next dental appointment is, but thank Christ I know Victor Sullivan's go-to word to describe a situation in which he feels uncomfortable. It's inky. This series, along with their previous and future work, has cemented developer Naughty Dog among one of the greats, despite what a vocal minority may have you think.
Oh my God!
Over the course of a series of videos, I'll be looking at the original trilogy on the PlayStation 3, what I think it nailed, what it failed at, and ultimately its legacy and impact on the gaming landscape. And to fully explore the narrative and themes of these games, I am spoiling the fuck out of all 3 game stories, no stone left unturned. So I'll be generous and give you 5 seconds to complete all 3 games, and then I'm moving on.
I don't think that's substantial time to finish.
Moving on! Uncharted Drake's Fortune was the result of the team wanting to move away from the cartoony and fantastical elements of their first properties, Crash Bandicoot and Jak and Daxter, and use the newer, more powerful hardware of the PlayStation 3 to create a more realistic world, taking cues from action pulp magazines and matinee serials to create a modernized take on action thrillers. Basically, the team said, what if Indiana Jones, but a gun? They wanted to take a stylized approach to realism, to embellish the visuals and create a unique, vivid world that felt alive and bright, all in an effort to veer away from the gritty, realistic shooters that were being released that embraced the now infamous gray, brown, and piss tones of the early next-gen console years. Jot this down in your handy-dandy notebooks, kids, because we're gonna circle back around to this shit. With the technological leap from the PS2 to the PS3, they were able to achieve so much more with development that wasn't previously possible. Skeletal structure to models so that they move, talk, and behave like real people. Muscular systems that allow for different parts of the body to contract and bulge based on what action the player is currently engaging in. 20 to 30 textures to a model, whereas PS2 models would have anywhere from 2 to 3 textures. 16 times the detail. Water physics, clothing simulation, ragdoll physics, like all of this shit is bonkers. You might think I'm spending an exorbitant amount of time on just the fucking graphics of a 16-year-old game, and you're right, but I have to set the stage for you. Naughty Dog's emphasis in games is pushing the boundaries of what can be achieved on screen, whether that's really impressive animations, draw distance, amount of shit happening within your direct line of sight. So when they moved onto the PS3, they took the opportunity to make as many technological jumps as they could, and you know what? It paid off. The game looked phenomenal. 15-year-old Topher was fucking floored at what games could be and where games were going. It could have also been that the only other game I had to compare it to was a full-priced copy of Lair. Yeah, do you remember Lair? The game that was made after someone asked, how do we make dragons boring? $60 is a shitload to a 15-year-old boy, Factor 5, fuck you! So yeah, you could say I'm something of an Uncharted tech intellectual. And really, I'm just trying to make you an Uncharted tech intellectual as well. We need more UTIs around here. More UTIs! This was their first game that utilized real motion capture actors to fully realize the scope of the narrative to their story, with the likes of Nolan North, Emily Rose, and Richard McGonagall to create a real cinematic Hollywood experience that a person could play rather than watch unfold. And it paid off in spades. While the actual visuals haven't aged perfectly,
Ooh.
The game delivers in an over-the-top experience that sets the stage quickly with two of our leads, Nathan Drake, the smarmy, smooth-talking treasure hunter, and Elena Fisher, the opportunistic journalist, as they retrieve the coffin of 16th-century explorer Sir Francis Drake, of whom Nathan claims to be a descendant. But as it's learned in your 5th grade social studies class and promptly forgotten for the rest of your life,
Francis Drake didn't have any children.
Opening the coffin reveals a long-lost diary belonging to Drake, but more importantly, no corpse in tow. I'm sure there's nothing to look into there, don't worry about it. Before long, a band of pirates encroaches on their position and transitions into the first playable section of the game, the tutorial. And this tutorial does a lot of good and bad things simultaneously. It efficiently teaches the player everything they'll need to know about combat in the game. Shooting, collecting ammo, taking cover, melee, how weakened enemies can be downed in fewer punches, and the best part? This is it. There's nothing else. I was lying, this is the worst part. You get grenades later, but as far as I can remember, I don't even think there's a tutorial for it when it's introduced. Shoot, punch, grenade. Rinse and repeat. This makes for a rather light gameplay experience, but I will touch on that in a moment. After fending off waves of pirates, the pair is rescued and we're introduced to Victor Goddamn Sullivan, the seasoned thief and mentor to Nathan, as he brings them to safer shores. It's here that Nathan explains to Sully that Francis found the City of Gold, El Dorado, and to avoid the word getting out to the public, Sully convinces Nathan to ditch Elena in pursuit of the treasure.
Yeah, boys! Ooh, 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 ooh!
Following the diary leads them to find that El Dorado wasn't a city of gold, but rather a massive golden statue, and picking up the trail of the Spaniards who got there first reveals a marooned Nazi U-boat. It's crazy, right? Well, strap in, because it's gonna get fucking nuts! Nathan traverses the U-boat and finds the mangled corpse of the captain and determines that the Germans were after the same treasure as Francis, finding the missing page of Drake's diary in the Nazis' possession. After using his explosive skill check to rearm a 60-year-old U-boat torpedo, Nathan leaves to find Sullivan has made some new friends, who happen to be old friends, who happen to be the bad guys. Enter Gabriel Roman and Navarro, our antagonists for the game. And if their introduction doesn't do it for you, then get comfortable because it's not getting better. These boys have the intimidation factor and on-screen presence of an elderly couple watching Judge Judy who can't determine which one is the plaintiff.
Jeez, does he always go on like this?
Take it easy, Navarro.
Yeah, Navarro, wouldn't want to hit our prisoners too hard. Roman tells Nate that Sully owes him a lot of money from their past dealings and that Sully already revealed their final on El Dorado, and in an attempt to threaten Nathan, just raw dog murders Sully in cold blood. No verifying that El Dorado even exists, no interrogating them for more information. Hey Roman, how's this method working for all the other people who owe you?
Take it easy, Navarro.
Oh, why do I never get my money back?
So Sully's dead. We literally barely knew you. Rip in peace, bitch.
A hanky.
But in the nick of time, the torpedo destroys the U-boat and gives Nathan a chance to escape, before finding Elena hot on their trail. They escape Roman's men and hightail it to the island where the statue had been relocated, until they're hit by anti-aircraft fire and parachute down, separated while the plane crashes elsewhere. It's not too long after exploring the island that you find yourself in the first firefights the game has to offer, and this is as good a time as any to really delve into the game's mechanics. To start, there is a lot to enjoy about the gameplay and the game as a whole. There's a sizable lineup of weapons to choose from that escalate as the game progresses, starting with smaller firearms from pirate caches and bumping up to stronger, flashier weapons in endgame areas. There's all sorts of fun animations throughout gunfights that set itself apart from other games in its genre. Nathan goes from a stroll to a dead sprint once someone has caught him or if he initiates the fight, as goofy as it may look. He can roll into cover and swap weapons on the ground mid-roll to very satisfying effect. Enemies will recoil at being shot, duck and retreat if a shot barely misses, and Nathan becomes more desolate behind cover when his luck is running low. Sidebar, the gradual desaturation of the screen to black and white is confirmed by the developers as Nathan's luck, not his health. As it fades, his luck runs out until he's shot and killed.
Call an ambulance! But not for me!
I like this, certainly a lot more than the Call of Duty approach of Smucker's blood jam cramming the outline of your screen.
Raspberry.
The level design in a few areas of the game is really creative and fun to experiment with. The arena-style sections are much more vast and open compared to more linear offerings within Drake's Fortune, and give the player a bit more agency as to how they want to approach fights. In one, you can take what looks to be a more cover-pronounced path that keeps you out of sight of mounted gunfire, or you can take a more risque route that can put you on the mounted machine gun early to conserve ammo and take out the remaining enemies with ease. In another wave-based section, you can take enemies head-on as they drop into the pit, move away from incoming swarms to collect ammo, or even climb to an upper area to survey the entire arena and have the higher ground. Also, this errs on the side of subjective, but the arena areas feel much more aesthetically diverse than other shootout sections. The reservoir is moody, low lighting, with structurally sound pillars from years of dormancy, and Nathan and every enemy is kicking up water with each footstep. And on the opposite side of the spectrum, the customs house is overly lit with a yellow tinge, vaulted ceilings, and a level of structural decay that's the result of weathering the elements. I really think environmental artists had a field day with these areas because they all feel incredibly unique from each other. Even moving through and exploring the world is entertaining. Seeing where you've been or where you're going to next makes the island feel more connected and gives you the sense of progression that a new level title by itself can't achieve. Crazy that this had never been attempted before in a video game. The sound design is stellar. Weapon fire is pronounced, some got that punchy to them. Enemies will call out your position, egg you on, and then die boisterously and spectacularly. Like, this shit is stupid. In the best way. Granted, every single long arm weapon that isn't a shotgun has the exact same reload sound. But like, whatever, I can look past that. And speaking of sound, the music? Oh, the music. Naughty Dog wanted to avoid the trappings of cliched action-adventure orchestral music when it came to the soundtrack, and thus enlisted the help of a guy named Greg Edmondson, composer of the hit show Firefly. You know, the hit show that was canceled after one season? I'm kidding, I'm sure it was good. Because I never watched it. He used this opportunity to complement the story about being on this island lost to time and the mystique and unease that comes with it by using a combination of ethnic instruments that lent itself to a feeling of claustrophobia from being in unfamiliar territory. Dare I say, uncharted territory? Everything from the menu sounds, wah, choo choo, to the horns, strings, and flutes incorporated in certain sections of the game. Drake, that's dangerous! And especially in combat. It keeps shootouts tense, there's a level of anxiety when you take too much heavy fire, and then the climax to whatever orchestral piece is playing during the fight. Bum bum. Bum bum. Wow. Shoot, doo, 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 doo. If we're being real with ourselves, the game wouldn't be half as good as it is without the music elevating it to a higher level. And more so side content than actual gameplay, but the treasure collecting aspect is a great way to tie collectibles into the narrative of a treasure hunter protagonist. And just look at some of this shit.
Lemonade.
With all that said, the gameplay overall is flimsy. While the guns look cool, sound good, and the in-combat animations are solid, the weapons themselves actually feel weightless. The recoil for most weapons just feels like,
okay, go stupid, ah!
And even with the several different animations for injuring enemies, there's really no feeling of impact between the shots and the kills. Remember the arena-style areas that I praised so much? But we also have the linear galleries, tighter spaces that allow for less creativity and player agency. Now instead of making little choices that you think benefit you and the character, you're essentially being funneled down pipelines with only one reasonable path to completion. It's like going down the It's a Small World ride at Disney, stuck on a boat with nowhere else to go, but with gun. And occasionally they'll throw in little gimmicks to mix up the formula, like the turret entrenchment that gives you a machine gun to mow down a secondary wave of pirates, or the spike trap area that has wired traps which put you into a QuickTime event in order to escape. The problem with this is that while it looks intriguing from a distance, not only do they offer you a get out of jail free card by supplying you with the grenade launcher before approaching, thus eliminating the initial threat immediately, but specifically with the tripwires, you are the only one affected by these traps. Enemies don't set them off. So little experimentation like trying to goad them into their own traps doesn't work. So why would I get myself tangled up in this shit if there is a clear path of least resistance? However, these tripwire traps do serve as a setup for a story beat later, so they're better executed narratively than mechanically, but I'll get into that later. The melee is serviceable. It works, but it's super limited. You have the trusty square button four times in a row, and the flashier but harder to pull off square, triangle, square brutal finisher. And in my experience, this one is hard to get right the first time, which really dampens the flow of combat. Button prompts are supposed to coincide with Nathan's hit on the enemy, but the input time often feels weird and leaves the animation failed and the enemy taking a shot at Nate. And it's not like there's any meaningful reason to go through with it. The reward is extra dropped ammo, and rarely are you going to find yourself in a situation where you're desperate for ammunition. So the best bet is to stick to old reliable, or even better, since the melee animation leaves you vulnerable to other gunfire, just use a fucking gun, stupid!
Hi, this is Streaming Topher. You can tell I'm Streaming Topher because I stream at twitch.tv/topherpro. If I can amend one thing in the review, it's that the brutal combo's actually piss easy to pull off. Observe! Alright, let's put this one to bed once and for all. Is the brutal combo actually that difficult? For now. Oh, fuck, it's not. Oh. Oh, no. Oh, no. Oh, boy. Oh, boy, it's actually a pretty easy window. There is such a massive window. Bitch! Brutal combo is the easiest fucking thing to do in the goddamn game. Fuck me, man. There it is, that's literally it. Alright, thanks for coming to my TED Talk.
And dude, I'm sorry, but this is a weak platformer. I recognize a platformer as being a game whose fundamental core is jumping, swinging, traversing, etc. to tackle obstacles and enemies. And sure, this game has all of that, but at its core, it's an exploration-based, story-driven third-person shooter. At its best, the platforming only serves to get you from point A to point B, like, duh, that's what a game is designed to do. But aside from a few exceptions, it never elicits a sense of awe that a narrative-focused game should. It shouldn't be a vehicle purely to move the player through a story, which is why later titles can be seen as bloated, but that's for some videos down the line. Truly, the only platform-driven, action-oriented set piece in the game, and the developers will tell you as such, is at the waterfall with the pirates and you go... That's fucking it! And at its worst, it's frustrating sections that bog down the pace to an already bare-bones experience. Call it the three pillars of gameplay all you want, but if the gunplay is bland, the melee is super basic, and the platforming is only contextually necessary, then it doesn't make for a fully fleshed-out time. Alright, sorry, that was a lot. Let's get back to the story. After a few skirmishes that lands you at the crash site of the plane and retrieving Francis Drake's map, Nate discovers Elena's abandoned parachute in the nearby fortress. Scaling the side of its walls and entering the compound, he's captured by the pirates and locked away before our introduction to, bless his heart, Eddie Raja.
Hey, Drake.
Eddie is a great foil to the more serious tones of Roman and Navarro, and honestly the one with a lot more personality. The back and forth banter of the two indicating a troubled past between them, the almost slapstick nature of the escape and retrieval of his map, it's chef's kiss. I know the game needed the other two antagonists to deliver the weightier side of the endgame, but personally, Raja is the king of the jungle, and my heart. And now we arrive at our first driving sequence, and if you're hoping this is a step above the rest of the gameplay, then buckle up, because not only is it as average as the rest of the combat, it's the best one in the game. Gunfire feedback is spotty, never really feels like shots are connecting, I can never tell if I need to be leading my shots with the grenade launcher, and overall, it's about as bland as an on-rails shooter section can feel. But it's the little ND touches, that's Naughty Dog if you didn't catch it, that at least make it a romp to get through. Shooting your grenade launcher in certain spots can down trees, blowing up vehicles sends tires and car parts fucking exploding in all manner of direction, and if we actually pause right here, this right here, dude was just taking a smoke break. What Nathan did, we in the industry call a dick move. After escaping from Raja and his men, we find out that Nate wants to use a boat outside the customs house to leave the island, while Elena wants to determine where El Dorado was moved from the shipping area. I think this is a great role reversal where a stalwart Nate, whose adventuring days have started long before this, is urging a curious Elena to give it up. She backs down and they agree that, regardless, they'll need to get to the customs house to get to the boat, and the only way through is on a jet ski. Okay, if this was a tier list, the quality of driving sections in the game goes from fine to poor to unwashed ass. First of all, on the jet ski, you both pilot the vehicle and shoot the weapon, but you can only do one at a time. You can drive the jet ski or you can shoot the infinite grenade launcher. If only one of them worked!
The driving is sloppy, quick acceleration off the bat, but then really wide turns that are hard to change direction until you decelerate and reposition the jet ski. Unless you want to look like Walter Jr. behind the wheel with all the stop and going, you are going to be causing some property damage. Then, when you aren't behind the wheel, you'll switch perspective to Elena, who can unleash a barrage of grenade launcher fire. But if the jet ski wasn't properly aligned to begin with, now you're doing this slow rotation to line up the shot like you're a cannon on a 19th century battleship about to take down a rival fleet for their
spice.
It's not that it isn't intuitive, it's about as easy as it gets. Point and shoot. It's just that the combination of these two mechanics aren't better than the sum of their parts. If you could steer and shoot, which is completely viable, there's no overlap of button inputs that would stop you from doing it, then I feel these sections would be a lot more fluid. It would allow good players to pull off the kinds of cool sequences that future titles in the series are known for. And I do commend this portion of the game for having actual environmental hazards that you need to take care of while juggling enemy fire. It melds the world and gameplay better than the previous tripwire areas, but still, sometimes it's like... Are you fucking kidding me? After navigating the sunken city and fighting their way to the customs house, they find the ledger that shows that El Dorado had passed through here from the original island and into the colony, before a subtle budding development in Nate and Elena's relationship.
Ooh, I hope they fuck.
After blasting through more pirates and finding some rather ominous-looking helicopters that look a bit above Raja's pay grade, they're stopped short of commandeering the boat to escape when Elena shows Nate some juicy footage she picked up. Soli's alive, and now they're headed to the monastery up north to confront him. But before that, they need to navigate a rickety old bridge, and being the klutz that she is, Elena breaks through and is narrowly saved by Nate. In order for him to pull her up, she has to give up the camera and all the footage that would have given her international notoriety. What most people don't know, however, is that after the cutscene and passing over the bridge, you can actually go below the wreckage and collect the camera for a secret collectible, leading to a hidden ending after the final boss fight. Traversing the ruins further, we find ourselves at the final driving sequence. This is, honest to God, the most jarring shift in quality for the game. We have taken the awful, unforgiving driving aspects of the driving parts of the jet ski, the slow, battleship-ass turning radius of the now infinite pistol, and married it to waterfalls. This is like slipping on an infinite banana peel upwards and told to hike Mount Everest. But with a gun. The worst parts of the driving are now exacerbated by clumsily trudging up the slopes of waterfalls, moving explosive barrels floating downriver, and also guys just hanging out on the ruins like, what the fuck are they doing here? Everything feels unnatural, the barrels are a one-hit kill, and nothing about this is satisfying. And by the time you've played through this enough, you've determined who and who not to kill to get through this bullshit as quickly as possible. This is by far the worst segment of this game, and I'm even comparing it to the final boss fight, but we will get to it. Hold your fucking horses. The only saving grace about this portion of the game is that it ends. After landing, Nate fights through a small wave before Elena comes face to face with a pirate adversary stuck in one of their own traps. The kicker, though, is that Nate discovers it wasn't Eddie's men that put the trap in his place. It was built from the scraps of Sully's plane. He deduces that something is watching them, not someone, and then quietly backs off when he realizes that Elena is getting the heebie-jeebies from his own little campfire ghost story. Now this is actually where the game starts gaining some legs, as we introduce the special ops members for the back half of the game. Navarro's hired henchmen pop up outside the monastery with red laser sight weapons, far more powerful than the pistols and automatic weapons from the pirates. Now to avoid certain gunfire, you have to dodge and roll around out of the laser sight.
As if a sniper would get frustrated. Look.
I can't keep up, he lives.
The sanctuary offers up a really atmospheric shootout with several lanes of direction to choose from, and then we're treated to the courtyard, which is all the best aspects of the arena-style shooting ranges. Lots of verticality as we now introduce snipers, as well as supplying one for yourself to either pop off on the snipers or pick off ground-level enemies from a distance. Lots of area to explore, whether it's to hop between cover to advance on enemies or back out if you become overwhelmed, and a sense of panic as several waves of foes will appear from different entrances to the courtyard, which means you could be in a good formation to take them on, or you may be right on top of them as they drop in on you. This is one of my favorite areas of the game, which is great because we'll be revisiting revisiting it later on. After the courtyard, we sneak up onto Soli in the library telling some spec ops guys about how he spun a fun-sized barmaid on his dick.
They called it a spinner because...
Will you shut up, old man?
Fuck, he's so cool! After dispatching the soldiers, Nate and Elena confront Soli about his supposed working with Roman and Navarro, to which Soli reveals that Drake's journal that he'd kept in his breast pocket saved him from Roman's attempted murder, which would never work in theory, but I'm just suspending all disbelief, especially with the shit that's gonna stir up later. They kept Soli alive as their means of finding the treasure, but he's mostly just been running them in circles. So with all the resources at their disposal and a symbol that will lead them to the treasure vault, Nate is charged with new vigor to find El Dorado. But god damn it, what the fuck is up with this puzzle? Everything up to this point has been, the circle block goes in the circle hole. This is literally pointing out where the statue should be pointing, but the way the information is laid out made it so fucking confusing. I know I'm not the only one stumped by this shit. It's the only puzzle from the first game that pops up in online forums like,
what am I looking at?
The puzzles lead to a channel of catacombs, sending Nate through the underground structure until he emerges in the cathedral. He takes a secret entrance back down into the tunnels until he finds himself below a conversation amongst Roman, Navarro, and Eddie Raja. Roman fires Eddie for being unable to capture Nathan and secure the island, while Eddie claims that the island is cursed and that his men are being slaughtered. Interesting. He sees himself out when Roman asks Navarro if he's worth the trouble as well, to which Navarro says,
El Dorado is worth more than you can possibly imagine.
Interesting. Nate makes his way back topside and finds himself at the top of the cathedral overlooking the cemetery, along with the mausoleum that Roman and Navarro are currently residing, right above the treasure vault. With a distraction from Soli back in the library, Navarro and Roman leave to allow Nate to make his way through the cemetery, meeting back up with Elena and Soli.
Yeah, sure to kill.
Finding the secret passage in the room, Elena and Nate pass through but are cut off from Soli when Elena activates a weighted trap. They navigate the maze-like structure and fuck these lanterns. We've gone from basic platforming sections to pixel-perfect climbing where these spiked pendulum fireballs are a one-hit kill. And yes, I have since seen gameplay footage where you just sidle along the edge to avoid the fucking things, but I'm talking about my time with the game. And my time with the game was sad. Moving past this room, you encounter Eddie and his remaining group navigating outside the treasure vault, where he's just foregone any sense of deal with Roman and wants the two of you dead. Taking care of Eddie's men and winding through the stairwells, you and Elena arrive at the treasure vault, devoid of one El Dorado. But there is a figure left crumpled on the vault's floors, Sir Francis Drake. The dude fucking died trying to get to this treasure, and all for naught. Nate drops his ring in defeat, the ring that led him to Sir Francis Drake's coffin, and as they look for a way out, Eddie pops his head back in, with a few unwelcome guests.
What the hell's going on out there?
Didn't you see them?
Oh no, oh god, no!
We're trapped!
Jesus, what is that?
We're dead! We're all dead! Ah! 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 No!
Eddie, get back here!
Yep, the island is infested with zombies. Eddie gets pulled into the murky depths by a zombie and dies, leaving Nate to fend off the waves before Elena can pull him up to safety. After locking the zombies away, they realize they've wound up in an underground Nazi bunker and need to access the generator room to get out of the compound. Elena can't make the trek out of the room and decides to stay put. Like, bitch, do I look like I'm in the mood to do a Scooby-Doo with you? Navigating the pipes and walkways, Nate reaches the other side and heads deeper into the bunker. And this is where shit gets turned up to 11. Turns out, El Dorado is cursed and transformed the Spanish colony into zombies. Francis Drake discovered this and destroyed the English ships and flooded the city in an attempt to prevent the treasure from leaving the island. So he's been rectified. He didn't die a bitch. He died a hero. But Nazis being the way they are and just taking shit that isn't theirs, revived the search and found it before the curse took over the company and ate these fuckers alive. So now we're not just dealing with regular zombies. They're Nazi zombies. Honestly, this is a nice little baby's first horror game. All the promotional work and behind the scenes clips the development team did, bragging about how vibrant and colorful the game is, was a really smart way of keeping this ace tucked up their sleeve for a bunch of unsuspecting tea for teens. Not that they'd ever use these deceptive marketing practices ever again. The dim, flickering lighting, use of interactive objects and minimal sound, the way the monsters snarl and claw their way towards you, these super tight corridors that are begging for zombies to jump out at you, the the only time these linear galleries are acceptable, by the way. A total fucking 180 to the philosophy of the game up to this point to serve up this scare fest. And it works to astounding effect. Getting into the generator room is the biggest clusterfuck. Opening up each door infinitely spawns zombies that... Are they infinitely spawning? I never sat around to find out. Hold on. So technically, at a certain point after opening the final door, they'll just kind of file in at a snail's pace. Probably because the cutscene leaving the area dictates that zombies are chasing you as you lock the door. But you can stop them from spawning in if you just stand still, so for a brief moment, you can wipe out the Nazis. Yes! We did it! In your face, certain parts of modern-day America. You're tasked with running from room to room, fighting the zombies and pulling levers to open up the next door like you're some kind of electrician or engineer in a fucking nightmare hellscape. With the power back on, Nate finds himself on the opposite side of the compound's crow's nest, and Roman and Navarro caught up and captured Elena. So we are Scooby-Dooing this shit, huh? They've got the map, they've got the girl, and they're on their way to a cursed treasure. But what they don't got is an undying will and a 60-year-old piece of rusted German hardware. Gesundheit. Now we're in a two-pronged skirmish between the special forces and zombies in a bid to save Elena and stop the treasure from leaving the island. And really, I wish more games would do this shit. If you play this area aggressively, it is so fucking fun to have mid-range firepower on one side, melee that fucking runs up to you on the other, and laser sight snipers from the crow's nests that has you ducking and weaving in and out of combat. Ascending out of the bunker, you find yourself back outside of the courtyard, accompanying a pinned down Sully as you take on hordes of the special forces. Snipers will start spawning into different high-up perches, forcing you to move throughout the area and assess who's the bigger threat to deal with at a time. Once their forces have been dispatched, the pair make their way up to the cathedral, the resting place of El Dorado. One final blowout takes place here, and while not as free and open as the courtyard, there's a certain harrowing factor to five snipers on the other side of the church, men on the ground floor approaching your cover-lacking area, and grenades being lobbed in your direction. As you take out their forces and push to the other side of the church, the script flips and men attack from the entrance, as well as the balcony above for one last desperate attempt to stop you. Nate and Sully find the hidden passage that leads to the treasure, but are caught by Roman and his men as he marvels at the treasure before him. But Navarro tells him the real treasure of El Dorado lies inside and instructs him to open it. And like taking a page out of a sitcom, things don't exactly go as planned. Navarro somehow knew the whole time about the El Dorado curse and plans to sell off the statue as a bioweapon to whoever waves the biggest check. Before long, the zombies swarm the area and Nate makes a mad dash for the airlifting treasure. He hangs on by a thread and is on his way back to Navarro's freighter when a soldier begins shooting at him. And it's like, have you watched a movie? Ever? Elena 300 kicks the bitch out of the helicopter, and not content being the only dude to die, shoots upwards and kills the pilot, sending the helicopter into a tailspin. Nate tucks and rolls away while Navarro and Elena crash on the other side of the freighter, and so begins the final showdown, and boy howdy do I have a few things to say about this. Navarro leads his last men to kill you, equipped with a laser sight shotgun while his forces all have regular shotguns. Taking out his men in one area causes him to retreat to a further part of the ship where we repeat the same shtick, inching closer to the downed helicopter. After we've forced him to the top of the stern, he blows up an explosive barrel, knocking our gun away and causing us to play a weird game of hide and seek. As he takes out each bunch of boxes, we gain ground until we engage in hand-to-hand combat, finishing him off and pulling Elena to safety. But oh, Navarro's still alive. And while he takes a minute to regain his footing, set a pot for tea, arrange his morning schedule, Nate just fucking bulldozes the helicopter off the side of the ship. I'm sorry, which came first, Uncharted or Resident Evil 5? Because both protagonists are like fucking modern day superheroes. And with Navarro's foot tangled in the rope that lifted El Dorado, he sinks to the bottom of the ocean. fittingly, the last victim of the treasure. Now look, this is all fine and dandy and shit, and it works, but also let me deconstruct the narrative and mechanical faults of this section to an anatomical level. The idea behind this section, where your only form of cover is destructible and gradually dwindling, is fine, but the inclusion of only shotguns screams that it was meant to pad the runtime of this area. Like if you use cheats, in-game cheats, I'm not a monster, to load in automatic weapons, this shit is over in a matter of seconds. But with the short range of the shotguns and usually taking 2 to 3 shots to finish off a single enemy, it's meant to make this feel longer than it actually is. Furthermore, every laser sight weapon we've seen thus far has clearly demonstrated that you simply need to roll in order to dodge or prevent incoming fire. But Navarro's gun plays by new rules. It's a 3-round burst in which the third shot will automatically kill you if you aren't in cover, no matter the distance. You can do whatever you want during those first 2 rounds, but so help me God, if you so much as give a soldier the stink eye out of cover on that last round, you're dead. You can't storm him or he'll auto-kill you even if you duck and roll the whole way there. This is taking what we've learned about the game and flipping it on its head in the worst way, completely opposite to the Nazi bunker, where we were subverting the look and feel of the game to dump us into a desaturated, claustrophobic portion for the sake of instilling a sense of horror. This is abandoning the core game design to funnel us down the narrative ending that they want us to experience. This is the most linear section of the game in which there's only one way to play, and you all know by now how much I love the linear sections. And the final combat encounter being nothing but a mindless QuickTime event? And narratively, this turns Navarro into the biggest, dumbest bitch villain in the entire trilogy. After being the crafty mastermind behind the whole plan to steal El Dorado for himself, he's reduced to being guarded by his henchmen, and the moment he gets a whiff of danger, he fucking bolts. Oh heavens, is that the stench of potentially dying? I shan't be staying. Why is he going to get up close and personal if he's only going to put his tail between his legs and piss off? One way this could have been improved is if the freighter design more closely resembled the crew expendable level from Call of Duty 4 Modern Warfare, with cargo containers interspersed throughout the main deck and Navarro overlooking the area below in his perch. You'd have to navigate the containers, taking out enemies while avoiding and dodging his line of sight. A bit of a cat and mouse game. He could even take shots at his own guys as they peek around corners hoping that it's you, a visible sign of his paranoia and desperation to take you out. Then, once you've reached a certain point, he can retreat to the top and you can have your fisticuffs fight as is scripted. I really don't know how to fix the Nate and Navarro personal fight, but dude, God of War did QuickTime events 2 years prior and handled it way better than this. And it's not like this plan of getting El Dorado off the island and selling it to the highest bidder was going to work out anyways. Somebody on board is gonna get curious, they're gonna open the treasure's door, they're gonna get infected and start murdering the remaining crew, leading to an off-brand Man of Medan ghost ship stuck somewhere in the Pacific. This was never going to work, and it's because Navarro's a big, dumb, idiot bitch. Sorry, I don't like unsatisfactory ending sequences. Nate saves Elena, Elena kept the ring necklace since it was Nate's prized possession, and right as they're about to get down and dirty with the scurvy, fucking Sullivan comes in and cock-blocks the two.
If I can't get any, no one can.
He managed to get off the island, secure a personal boat, and haul off with what purportedly looks like fucking millions in gold. They look back at the island where the zombified Spanish/German population is mostly eviscerated by this point, and Nate apologizes that Elena lost her footage, assuring her that he's good for the next big story of hers. And then the fucking theme song just goes, na 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 na, na na na. Oh, banger! When all's said and done, Drake's Fortune is a flawed game that is just super fucking fun to pick up. From enemy encounters that are enriched with slick animation and outstanding sound design and music, to the characters and the twisting and turning story they find themselves in, it's a very tightly packed experience. And by tightly packed, I mean fucking crushed. This game can be beaten in as little as 2 hours. The game is fun, but goddamn is it bare bones. I give this game a 6 out of 10. 6 is still generous. You've just been conditioned by review sites to think that 7 is shit. It's a good game. Still, it's hard to believe that some people think that this did not deserve a sequel. Ooh. While I think this is far from Naughty Dog's best outing, a conventional and uninspired gameplay loop that it was, Gears of War came out the preceding year and did all the third-person cover shooter stuff far better. The original Uncharted laid the entire groundwork for future titles, exploring unknown locations, treasure hunting, relatively tight gameplay, narrative intrigue, like all the pieces are here. Because goddamn, if we didn't have Uncharted 1, then I wouldn't be able to make a follow-up talking about Uncharted.
Hey guys, this is Outro Topher. It's the only thing I forgot to record, so this is how the video ends. Sorry! Thank you for checking out this retrospective review. This is the single largest project I have personally worked on, so if you enjoyed it, leave a like, and be sure to subscribe if you want to see more stuff like this. I know I'm definitely going to revisit the sequels at some point. I will see you next time, and until then, aim for the bushes! Brutal combo incoming! Oh fuck! Fuck!